Hello, in this presentation we will discuss the topic of standardized assessment. Specifically, we will describe the characteristics of standardized assessment and discuss a series of misconceptions related to this type of evaluation. We will also discuss the differences between different forms of standardized assessment, focusing particularly on the distinction between norm-referenced and criterion-referenced tests. And finally, we will provide some guidelines on how to communicate the results of standardized assessments to parents. Standardized assessments are commonly referred to as large-scale assessments. The defining characteristic of standardized assessment is uniformity. Uniformity in content, administration conditions, as well as in scoring procedures. This means that all individuals who are taking a standardized assessment are given the same directions, the same questions or questions that are considered equivalent in content and difficulty level, and are assessed in the same type of setting. There are many standardized measures that are well known, like the driver's license examination, for instance. In education, some well-known standardized assessments are the SAT, the GRE, Praxis for teachers, or intelligence tests such as the Stanford-Binet. An important question is, why are standardized assessments necessary or how are they useful? Well, a major advantage of standardized assessment is that it allows comparisons. The raw scores obtained by students on these assessments are also standardized. They are put on the same scale. This procedure allows educators to compare scores across students and also to make comparisons across subject areas to determine the strengths and weaknesses of each student. A common misconception about standardized assessment is that only commercially published tests can be standardized. In reality, any type of assessment, even teacher-made tests, can be standardized if the principle of uniformity in content, administration, and scoring is strictly followed. There are several types of standardized assessment. Based on the content being assessed, we have achievement tests, which measure how much students have learned in various academic areas, and aptitude tests, which measure students' potential in certain areas and are typically content-free, like intelligence tests. Based on the scoring procedure, we have criterion-referenced tests, where the score is determined by comparing the individual's performance to predefined standards. This is also called standards-based scoring in education. In essence, grading here is based on an interpretation of a student's degree of mastery of the learning goals. And we have norm-referenced tests, which we'll discuss in more detail on the following slides. Norm-referenced tests compare individual scores to the scores of a norm group, which is a representative sample of students who have taken the same test. A norm-referenced score represents the individual's standing relative to the norm group, and not the level of content mastered. Therefore, results of a test may differ if the score is compared to a local norm group, which can be selected at a school, district, or state level, than with a nationwide norming sample. A common misconception is that norm-referenced tests always compare people who take the test at the same time. This may be true for some tests, such as the SAT or the GRE, but most often the norm group was selected by the test designer and took the test in the past. When interpreting norm reference scores, it's really important to make sure that the norm group has similar characteristics or is representative of the students who are currently taking the test. Otherwise, the interpretation provided can be misleading and can lead to validity issues or inaccurate decisions regarding students' achievement. For instance, if the results of a fourth grade student are compared to those of fifth graders, his test results may indicate lower levels of achievement and may lead to inappropriate decisions regarding his educational needs. To derive meaning, educators rely on the normal curve or the normal distribution, which is thought to characterize many human traits. Student scale scores on the norm reference test are standardized, are transformed into norm reference scores, such as percentile ranks, stanines, NCEs, which stand for normal curve equivalent scores. z-scores, t-scores, and so on. These scores are using different computation procedures, but they all reflect the individual's standing in relation to the norm group. This figure is useful because it represents the range, the mean, and the standard deviation of different types of norm reference scores, as well as their location in relation to one another. For instance, we can see that z-scores have a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1, whereas t-scores have a mean of 50 and a standard deviation of 10. We can also see here that a score that is one standard deviation below the mean corresponds to a z-score of minus 1, a t-score of 40, an NCE score of 30 is located in the third stanine and above or at the same level as approximately 16% of the population. Some of the most frequently used norm reference scores are percentile ranks, which indicate the percentage of students in the norm group who scored below or at the same level. Test reports typically include a confidence interval for the statistic, which takes into account measurement error and shows the interval where the student's score is most likely to be located if he or she takes the same test again. And there is a certain level of confidence for this estimation, such as 95% or 98%. Stanines are another type of norm reference scores. The name for this statistic comes from the standard nines because the normal distribution is divided into 9 equal intervals, as illustrated in the previous figure. They have a mean of 5 and a standard deviation of 2. They are very helpful, especially for longitudinal comparisons, to determine the progress that students make across years compared to their peers. To illustrate the interpretation of norm reference scores, I included a sample test report from the Terranova test, which is a norm reference test. For this particular student, the scale score for the language section of the test is 678, which doesn't tell us much, so we need to look at the standardized scores in order to make comparisons. The percentile rank for the language score is 64, which means that the student scored above or at the same level as 64% of the students in the norm group. And if he takes the test again, the percentile rank would most likely fall somewhere between 53 and 72. This score is in the 6th stanine and is the highest score from all of the sections of the test, while the lowest score is on social studies, which is in the 4th stanine and the 37th percentile rank. Criterion-referenced tests compare an individual's performance to a set of content standards to determine the extent to which these standards were met. Therefore, they're focused on content mastery as a basis for comparison, rather than the performance of peers. Criteria for performance levels are chosen at the state or at the national level, such as the Common Core State Standards. Educators often have to explain or interpret the results of standardized assessments for parents. They have to be able to explain the meaning of the scores, how the scores were calculated, what were the evaluation criteria, what is required to pass the test, whether a student made significant progress, and how does the student score compare to the score of other students. When communicating test results to parents, educators should always explain the purpose of the assessment and what it measures, and explain the basis of comparison, whether it is norm-referenced or criterion-referenced, and what this means. The test report often includes several types of standardized scores. The educators can choose one type of score, for instance the percentile rank, and explain what the score represents for the student. The educator should use the scores on the test to identify the strengths and weaknesses of the student and indicate the areas that need improvement. He or she will communicate to the parent how instruction will be adjusted and recommend activities that would support student progress. In addition to conclusions about the progress and educational needs of individual students, standardized test reports also inform educators on the level of performance of an entire group of students at the classroom, school, district, or even state level. This information should be examined to identify common patterns. For instance, if all the students in one class have lower scores on writing, This suggests that instruction in this area was limited and needs to be improved. Therefore, results from standardized assessment should be used to adjust instruction based on student needs. In this presentation, we discuss the topic of standardized assessment. We describe the characteristics of standardized assessment and some of the misconceptions related to this type of evaluation. We differentiated between different forms of standardized assessment and discussed the distinction between norm-referenced and criterion-referenced tests. We also discussed how to communicate the results of standardized assessments to parents. I hope that the explanations provided were clear and that this information is helpful to you.